What hormone-free birth control do you know?
Condoms.
Hormone-free, there's this, I don't know how you call it, it's like a spiral, and it's made out of some metal, and that's without hormones, and other than that, condoms, I guess, and yeah.
Maybe preservatives, like condoms?
I just heard of, like, that they're becoming a new thing, and that they're trying to check if they're safe or not, but I don't know any.
So this is a new development where we see that outside of the medical care field, but basically through an app store, new types of contraceptive practices are arising. So there's a wide variety of birth control methods that you can use on your mobile phone. Some people use a simple menstruation app that predicts fertile days to prevent pregnancy. Other apps are marketed as a contraceptive. For example, temperature-based apps that use algorithms to determine the fertile days. But there's also apps that are basically digital versions of pen and paper, where people can use digital tools to employ a learned fertility awareness-based method. I often get the question whether these apps or methods based on fertile days work. This is an interesting question, but also one that is hard to answer, because there's a wide variety of apps. Some are not researched at all, some are researched to some degree, and some are have a better evidence base. So it really depends what app you're using, what method this app is based on, but it also depends on the user. In my study with people who use apps to prevent pregnancy, I did get a lot of feedback from people saying that they transitioned towards these kind of tools because they were unhappy with their hormonal contraceptives. So obviously side effects and health risk are on their minds. But I also see worries about more wider implications of hormonal birth control. For example, possible environmental implications because of the synthetic hormones that you ingest and come into the environment through the wastewater, or effects on moods and personality, partner choice, and these kinds of less medical and more existential effects of hormone use. And this is a reason for people to consider, what does it really mean that I use a contraceptive sometimes from a really young age, as young as 14, 15 years, and then using that contraceptive for another decade and a half or something? What does that really mean for me as a person and my personal development, that I am suppressing ovulation, basically, using hormonal contraceptives? So this is a reason for people to say, I'm curious what it feels like to not use this birth control, what would happen and what my cycle is like, and people haven't had a chance to really explore that part of themselves. So I see that it's also part of a self-exploration in some sense.
And does your physician also inform you about alternatives?
I don't really go to a physician right now, but I'm assuming they do.
No, she doesn't, no.
No.
Not really, I think.
No, not for me.
Yeah,
like,
not for me either.
I don't know, I come from South America, like back home it's usually the more basic, the more general known types of like anticonceptive methods.
Yeah, same. I'm from India, so exactly same. Like, it's the same thing.
I looked at both online spaces where users come together, as well as spaces where care providers are educated about these methods. And I found an interesting tension there, where in online spaces, sometimes apps are promoted that don't really have a good evidence base, and they're promoted as being really effective. Whereas in spaces where providers are taught about these methods, and in guidelines, these methods are painted as ineffective. And I think both claims need nuance. So I think it is really important for people who choose to use these methods to know exactly, is the method I choose evidence-based or not, and how effective is it? If you look at studies looking at the effectiveness of these methods. On the other hand, I think that the idea that these methods don't work also needs nuance, in the sense that it really depends on the method you choose to use and whether you use it correctly and consistently, whether you've been trained and have the right support to use these methods, and your motivation to prevent a pregnancy. So some methods are more effective than others. And I think this information needs to be made more accessible in guidelines and could really help patient-centered counseling on these methods. So my advice for care providers who are confounded with people who prefer non-hormonal methods is to, first of all, look at our publication, because we give some recommendations also for practice. And I believe that the guidelines, the clinical guidelines at the moment in the Netherlands, do not really give enough information about these methods to counsel on these methods well. In our publication, we also refer to systematic review of evidence on these methods. This systematic review is not yet available in the clinical guidelines, but it does give an overview of which methods have sufficient evidence base. And it gives information about how to use these methods, what are the requirements for use, and this could be a basis for counseling on these methods if patients wish to do so.